everyone. Welcome to episode 31 of Concussion Chats. My name is Taya. Concussion Chats, the podcast hosted by the McGill Students for the Concussion Legacy Foundation with the help of Nick from Concussion Talk podcast. We're dedicated to providing strength and hope to those recovering from concussions through sharing experiences. Today I have a recording of our guest speaker, Guillaume. Guy is a civil engineer who has been dealing with PCS for 6.5 years and has suffered 10 concussions. He's working now as an autonomous worker part-time and enjoys various outdoor activities and sports, playing piano, reading, and traveling.
Yes. Hi, everyone. Nice to meet you all. Happy to be here today. So I'm going to talk about my accident, what happened. It's kind of a funny, interesting story. I will tell you about everything I went through to recover, all the pain, all the gains. And but first, I'd like to start a bit with a bit of a history about myself. So when I was 28 years old, I was just done paying back my student loan. So I was really happy about that. And I worked really hard. You know, it was like a big debt. So I decided to take 4 months off for my job and to travel Asia. So after that, I was thinking, okay, when I come back, I can get like a better job. I can maybe like get a stable relationship, settle down, you know. And so the plan was just like traveling for 4 months and then, you know, starting like on a fresh slab. So I went to Asia, and after 3 weeks, I was biking around. I just had like a small backpack, and so I was I traveled in Thailand, and then I was in Laos, and so it was December 31st, 2014. And I went just biking close by, and I thought to myself, oh, I don't need a helmet. It was really a small village, you know, only like a few motorbikes, and it was really a quiet place. And I just remember like going back to my hotel a bit past midnight. And then the next day I woke up in the hospital in China with a neck, a jaw injury, broken nose, broken teeth, concussion. And I just woke up in the bed. There was a policeman next to me, told me he found me on the street, brought me to the hospital. I lost consciousness for about 4 or 5 hours, or at least my memory. And I don't know how I went to China, why I woke up there, but they were nice enough to give me some medication, just clean up my face. And then they brought me back to the border with Laos. They gave me my bike and they said like, okay, now I bike back to your hotel in Laos. And I was like, but can you help me? Like, I cannot move my neck. And it was so, so painful. And I didn't have my passport to cross the border. But finally, I went through the border. I made a report. The authority in Laos, they let me in. And then, like, the real journey started. Because at first, I thought it wasn't too bad that maybe I had drunk the day before or something like that. And I just felt off. But When I realized, well, first, I think I was bumped from behind by a car because my luggage support at the back was all bended and was like solid metal. So I guess it was a bad accident. And so I was in a really small village in northern Laos. Internet was working pretty bad. I was alone. I could not speak the language, neither in China. And it was hard to communicate. And I would walk like 10, 15 minutes and I needed to rest like 2-3 hours. So I waited like 2 days and then I decided to take the bus to slowly go to Thailand for a better hospital because Laos only has like a good hospital in the capital. So I thought it was worth it to go to a safer place in Thailand. And then the doctors were telling me like, take a rest, you know, that's all you can do for now. And I knew that my jaw was not right and my neck, you know, it was still messed up and everything. But when I was resting a lot, I was feeling better. And then after 2 weeks, I was like, okay, I think, you know, I can, because I took 4 months off and I rented out my apartment and it was all planned. And I was like, I'd rather rest in Asia than go back to Canada in the winter and just feel terrible there. So I decided to stay in Asia and travel just like slowly, not going to parties and just museum, walking around. It was fine. And then I came back to work. And then this is when I realized how bad it was because I would just you know how screens are bad for concussion. And I didn't want to tell anyone about my concussion. I just wanted to work. And I had worked so hard for this civil engineer position. So I really tried my best, but I was crashing and, just adrenaline and having a lot of coffee to be able to work. But then after 2-3 months, I was really like feeling bad. I had to sleep for like a month and a half. And then I started to go to this rehab center for concussion. And so I was seeing like a neuropsychologist, kinesiologist for exercising, obviously a doctor. There was a social worker. So they were like trying to help me with advices and such, but really it wasn't working well. And I felt like I was on a plateau, like I wasn't improving. But after 5 months of like just being at home alone and feeling bad, I was like, this is so stressful not to be working, that I pushed my doctor to bring me back to work. And I told myself I would have like better habits if I work, because it drives me insane to be stuck at home doing nothing. And it was a really bad idea. I went back to work too soon. And I tried part-time, it was not too bad, but with the peer pressure at work, they don't see like the concussions. So they think, you're fine. And your teammates are working late. Why aren't you working late? So it did like another burnout. And I tried hard for 2 years to go back to this position. But after 2 years, I really wasn't reliable. And I told my boss, he agreed, like, okay, you need to take a break. Something is not going on well. And just take care of yourself. So after that, I discovered that a jaw injury is quite bad for the sleeping patterns. And because I just talked with a friend and he had a jaw issue too, with this small joint here. And so it makes some muscle tensions and it goes in your neck. And it's bad for sleeping. You cannot recover from that. So I started to sleep better at least. And I saw the dentist, gave me like this splint, like a mouth guard for a night. That really helped me with the physiotherapy. But still, I was still like feeling not so well. And trying the visual vestibular therapy, it was going up and down. Like I couldn't get it. And I also tried a cortisone shot in the neck. I had 6 of them, and that was so painful and so useless. I don't recommend these very much. They say like it will reduce inflammation in your neck. Maybe you have something in your neck and it causes like pain in your jaw, but that was like a big waste of time. And finally, after 3 years, I had a recommendation from a friend to see a chiropractor that was really good with concussion. And I went to see him because I was really desperate. I couldn't work anymore and I didn't know what was going on. And he told me like, because I did like a week of intensive functional neurology there. And he told me, I think you have some metabolic issue. And we were like looking for it. And we did like blood samples that we sent to the States, to Cyrex laboratories. It's more specialized, it's faster. And so I was spending like a lot of money, and we didn't find anything in the allergies that could affect my brain or make me have like chronic inflammation. So we went, so the chiropractor told me, I think you have a bacteria or something, there's something wrong with you. And I went to see a nutritionist, she said the same thing. I went to see my doctor, and he said, no, I don't think you have, like, my family doctor is really clueless since the beginning, I have to admit. Like, he helps me with the insurance, but he's not that old, but he's not up to date with the concussion information, all the new technology. And he got me depressed because he was just telling me like, oh, if you're stuck like this, there's nothing we can do. You're already doing everything you can, and just accept it and, like try to work around that. So anyways, I changed doctor, and it was getting more and more obvious. At that time, I was really tired, like sleeping 10, 12 hours a day, and a lot of stomach pain, and things were really not going well, psychologically either. I had all the post-concussion syndrome symptoms, and it was really annoying. So So a doctor gave me antibiotics after a test for Helicobacter pylori came back positive. It's a bacteria in the stomach. And it changed everything. Everything was like 10 times better. Finally, I could like do all the stuff I wanted to recover from the concussion, but they didn't give me like the right dosage for the antibiotics. So I had to take another dose twice as strong. And then it took a while. And you know, to solve this issue, it took like a year. Because I needed like three treatments of antibiotics, because the doctors, they in Quebec, they are not very careful with what they do, and they didn't give me the right dosage of antibiotics. And with all the delays here, it was crazy, and it got me like really impatient and even like insane, because like after two shots of antibiotics, the insurance, they stopped and they said like, you're not sick anymore, you can work now, you have no reason. And the doctor was like, well, we already solved your problem. So, you know, it's all in your head. There's nothing else that we can do. But yeah, I needed a third shot of antibiotics. And I finally saw a specialist, a gastroenterologist, who gave me the right dosage and this and that. So after 4 years and a half of fighting so hard and trying and, you know, just failing, my self-esteem was really down, because well, not just my self-esteem, it's just like it gets in your head when you just experience so much negativity and failures, and you know, all your life is changed, and you're told for so long that you're gonna stay like that way. But I tried to make it better. I went to Costa Rica for 2 weeks. I went to see my brother in Europe for a month and a half, just to like recover a bit and you know, like do something else, not stay at my place. And it did help me psychologically, but every time I would come back to Montreal and just live alone and do like visual rehab and just too tired at night to go out because of the exercises and not working, feeling like the loneliness, a bit like the pandemic, but really extended to many, many years. So yeah, it's I was not getting so much better, but with the anti-inflammatory diet and you know, like the good habits, it does get a lot better. And I think I'm talking a lot, but I should talk about like all the treatments that helped me through the time. So first, you have to treat a bit of everything at the same time. Because if you have a neck or jaw issue, it makes you tired. It can like play with your vision, a lot of things. So that's one thing you have to check. I highly recommend an anti-inflammatory diet with low carb. That helps a lot. I took some notes here. That obviously, mindfulness is a major player for like calming your emotions and feeling better. There's a lot of benefits from that. Physical activity, for me, it's also like, because you need to recover the normal blood flow in your brain. So for me, I try to do it almost every day in the morning, and I went progressively, so it got better and better. Socializing, for example, this group, you know, connecting with people with similar injuries, but also like being surrounded with people who lift you up. I found for resilience also, if you make some art or if you turn this negativity that you felt for the concussion, for example, and you turn it into a positive thing, like helping other people or just expressing your story through art, that can help. Finding a meaning in your life. If you have some love, if you want to take care of someone, if you want to do something for the community, that also helps a lot. The visual and vestibular rehabilitation is important. Sleeping is also very important, sleeping well. I don't want to go through everything. I think you guys can do a research, but you know, like avoiding caffeine, having a calming routine before bed, avoiding alcohol, eating too much, avoiding stress, these kind of things. And I read a few books that helped me tremendously. There are two books from Norman Deutsch. This one is it's in French, but you can the original version is in English, and it's about neuroplasticity and how you can like change your brain. There are two books from him. Norman Deutsch, he's really good. I can write it down after. Again, it's in French, but it's two books about psychology, like how you feel and how to manage like difficult people, how to understand people. Because me, the emotional stress for me was a big factor, because it would go in my jaw and I couldn't sleep anymore. I had like terrible chronic pain for many years. And for resilience, I recommend this book. I can find the English version after. It's this author is very famous. He was a Jewish person who lived the war, and his parents, his family got killed, and the rest of his life he spent it like understanding the meaning of life and helping people with resilience. He's a famous psychiatrist. And for mindfulness meditation, I recommend this author here. He's very cool. Like he's from India, but he had to go to he's from Tibet, and he was like a monk, a Buddhist monk for a while. And when the Chinese invaded Tibet, he had to go to India, and he became like the official translator of the Dalai Lama. And at 30 years old, he wanted to establish a family. So he moved to the States. He did a PhD in neurology, and he applies like the principle of Buddhism without the religious stuff to mindfulness and compassion, caring about other people. And like it's really like a mentality, a mindset that makes you really peaceful. And there's a lot of meditation through the books. And this one is like for the diet. In Quebec, she's a very good nutritionist, and could give you tips about the diet. But maybe I'll send you some links, because time flies. And just want to check if I didn't forget anything. Yeah, playing music also helps me a lot to calm my mind, and it's a really good brain exercise. Also to activate the creation of new neurons. You know, if you summarize what is in the Norman Deutsch book about neuroplasticity: avoid stress, avoid fatigue, avoid drinking, avoid smoking, and exercise, aerobic exercise. And consistency, it's like learning how to play Beethoven on the piano. You have to practice every day, and you start slowly with some notes. But you have to do this for like 6 months to really learn the song. And at some point, you're gonna try to start to forget about the song, how to play it. So you have to make a refresh. But well, it's the same thing with the movement of your eyes, with your balance, this kind of thing. If you want to recover your brain, it's hard work during many years, and you have to feel like very calm, zen, and always keep like a positive attitude, good nutrition, socializing. Psychologists also helped me. But I don't want to go for too long, so I think maybe I should let some questions in, or Taya, I don't know how to proceed.
It's up to you. If you want to keep going a little bit longer, you've got some time. But if that's it, then you're good.
So maybe one thing that I should say is I cannot emphasize how much the metabolic issue is a big, big factor. You know, when they gave me antibiotics, they said also that they killed the parasite at the same time. And, you know, that the test couldn't reveal the parasite, but because the chronic fatigue went away, the mood swings went away, depression, it really like it went away. Like I still had it after for other reasons, but it wasn't on the same level. And you know, like it started to work out to recover from the concussion from there. So I was really bad lucky with the bacteria and the parasite, and it took a long time, and then it went like a bit It wasn't so bad, but because it was many problems, and I had to like solve every one of them, and they all influence each other, and I had to learn how to be my own doctor, it went like worse. But there's always a room for improvement, and I guess maybe I want to send you like the picture of me with the Chinese policeman with my face all bruised up. But I don't know if it's something that interests you guys, because it's a bit intense. You know, it's really messed up. But if you feel interest, it's funny to watch. Well, not funny, but you know, you can see like the how far I came from, because you know, at first I was working 10, 15 minutes. I needed to sleep 2-3 hours. And last summer I ran a half a marathon. It went well. So there's like a big improvement. And now it's the screen time that is not high enough for me, long enough that I'm working on, like still working on the visual vestibular therapy. But yeah, I think from here, I'll take some questions.
Today I have Emily, who is also part of McGill Students for the Concussion Legacy Foundation, Nick from Concussion Talk Podcast. Before we get started about Guy's share, I just wanted to say, like, Guy was one of the very first people to start coming to support meetings when I started running them. And then he was like the first consistent person. So I've known him for like the last 2 years while I've been doing support. And he's just really great. I like love him. He's amazing. And his story is crazy. But he's doing so much better. He's doing so well now. It's awesome to see. It makes me so happy.
Have you noticed a change like in him in those support groups?
Yeah, definitely. He's definitely a completely different person, but like in a good like way, of course. Like when I first met him, he was definitely I think he was kind of losing like hope that like he would get better kind of thing, and just very frustrated because it had been like so long since his accident. And then like he like slowly started to kind of like, he found out about like the bacteria thing in his stomach. And then that kind of started to help everything, and things started to improve. And then he was able to start working. And he's just, yeah, he just seems like he's in a really great place right now. It's awesome.
So Emily, you want to do it? Or been?
Yeah. Yeah. And I think
same thing?
Yeah, I think Taya pretty much sums it up there. When we first met him, he was definitely, I mean, only because he's talked about it with me. He was, like, really depressed. And he talked about in the talk, just being hopeless. And that's where he was. He's just, I don't know. I just wanted to, like, give him a hug and be like, it's going to be okay. And now he's, I don't know. He's so much happier.
Is he like active in the chats? I mean, after we hear these speeches, is he very active, or is he just?
He doesn't go to meetings as much anymore, just because like he works now. So I think he also still struggles with like screen time. I know that's one thing that he still kind of struggles with. But he's messaged me a couple times being like, I can't wait for like our in-person meetings to start back up. Like, so that'll be nice. But yeah, he definitely was very like, he was at a low point, but like, he still was like so caring. Like, we'd always like make sure I was doing all right and like make sure I was good and stuff. But, I'm glad to see him doing so much better.
That's awesome. Yeah. His story was, intense. It was like, that's, and I guess when you travel and you're in like, that was almost like not quite the Golden Triangle, but like, I guess you probably went through there, but the whole like Thailand, Laos, and Myanmar, Burma, that's he was in next to China, like with Thailand, China, Laos and China.
He was in Laos, and then like he got brought to China, I think.
Yeah, he was not.
And then like from China, like they brought him back to like the border and told him to like bike back to his hotel, like
and after he hadn't
been in the hospital, and like he was just so like clearly not okay. I didn't realize how early in his trip it was. I didn't realize it was only 3 weeks into the 4 months. That was something new that I found out. Like,
I have no idea. I've never been there, but I wouldn't think crossing the border from Laos to China would be too easy. But I guess in certain places it probably is.
Well, he didn't have his passport, so he said it was a whole big thing. But I can imagine it's all a bit of a blur.
He didn't have a passport?
He wasn't planning on crossing. So, he said a police officer took him to the hospital. So who knows how he got across the border. Oh. But to go back to his hotel and stuff, he said that he had to talk to the border people and it wasn't an easy thing. But he eventually got across. It's a crazy story.
It is. That's
insane.
Yes, you guys know him pretty well now, so it's almost ready for you guys to not there's not much, but let's see, perfect as far as what to count on or say, because you know him well and you've seen him kind of improve these past 2 years now, so
yeah.
So now what else to pick out, I guess.
I mean, that in itself, just being able to say I've known him for the past 2-ish years and seen him improve is also just cool to think about. First off, just being wow, I've been running this support group for 2 years, that's crazy.
Yeah.
But also just thinking that I've known Guy while he's been going through all these things and we've maintained contact.
So
with the pandemic, I haven't talked to him as much. But anytime I do see him, he just looks like he's doing so much better. And he'll be telling me about, he's working now. He's just life is a lot more fulfilling, it sounds like. And so it's great to hear for sure.
So the goal of his whole gut biome situation, was that something he was feeling when he was not feeling well because of that in your groups when you started? Or?
I think later into us getting to know him a little later in is when the gut bacteria antibiotic thing kind of started. And he said that happened after 3 years, his friend told him about a chiropractor that's good with concussion, whatever, and they did a bunch of stuff and then the chiropractor and whoever read the samples said that there was a bacteria. A nutritionist said the same, but his family doctor was nah, there's nothing. And then that kind of made it really hard for him, because he was just very discouraging. He was sleeping all the time, but he's still so tired. And I remember he used to message me and be sorry, I missed the meeting. I'm just really tired kind of thing. And he was always so apologetic about it. I was oh my God, no, why are you apologizing? Take care of yourself. But, the antibiotic thing, that sounds like that's what really, really helped him turn things around. That seems like it helped.
Is there a chance he got a bug and passed out? Is there a chance he caught a bug in Lao and then just maybe stung or bitten by a bug and then passed out in his head? Or the lounge whiplash?
No. No idea. It's a mystery.
Yeah.
It was nice that he also just talked about things how once he was 4.5 years in, his self-esteem was just terrible, and how everything was just shit. And he talked about how he tried to make it better, and he went to Costa Rica, he visited his brother for a while, but as soon as he'd come back Montreal, it was just kind of the same thing. And he said his anti-inflammatory diet and good habits helped a lot. And
I was talking to Tanya when I first talked to you last year in like March just before the pandemic actually officially started. You were saying that you're like you're the support groups in person. Did you come to those?
Hey, oh yeah, yeah, yeah. He came to I think almost every single one. And if he didn't, usually it was like
in Montreal.
Pardon?
He's in Montreal.
Yeah, he's like not right downtown, he's like further out, but yeah, he would come to the meetings. Yeah, he was almost always at the meetings. Could always count on Yi to have someone there. Mm-hmm. But yeah. I don't know. I'm just happy he's doing so well. I don't have too much to say. But yeah.
Yeah, he talked about there being like he mentioned a mindset. You know, there's one thing about Guy is like he just like kept trying things. He kept moving, and he was, and I know when we met him, he was really depressed, and did he talk about being on antidepressants in his talk?
He did mention it, yeah.
Yeah, so I know that was like a really tough thing for him to decide to do. And he texted me a few months back. He was like, I'm on antidepressants. It was a good decision. And that's awesome, you know, having that, like, willingness to, like, try things even if you don't want to and being open-minded about it, seeing if it, you know, is a good thing for you. And so I think, you know, that's been one thing that's really amazing. And the other thing is he, although I don't know how good at it he was always, he's always been really adamant about doing things that he knows he enjoys. He's always talking about going rock climbing, always talking about, you know, just that resiliency, I think is pretty amazing. It's gotten him to where he's at.
He definitely did kind of like always, he didn't just kind of not do anything. He made sure that he still did all the things that he enjoyed. Even if, like, you know, he ended up paying for it later, he just, you know, still did it because, like, needed something. And, like, you mentioned, Emily, like, when we first met him, like, he was really, really depressed. He was also pretty, like, against taking medication. Like, he didn't want to do that. So, for him to, like, take medication now, like, that's also just huge and amazing to just, like, because, like you said, like, he doesn't stop trying. Like, he, like, exhausted all the other things, and then he decided, you know, like, give that a shot, which is great. And he was also just talking about, like, finding, like, meaning in your life, like, when he was talking about, like, the treatments that helped him sort of thing, he just kind of brought up just, like, finding meaning in your life, like, doing something for someone, and, like, for someone you love, or, like, some involvement with, like, community and stuff like that, and I think that's also a really important part.
When you mentioned that list at the end of things to do, like you said, we have 4 minutes, and he said, okay, well, I should mention this. Need this out, a bunch of stuff. He looks, obviously, I've written down somewhere. Should, like, as you said, do something for the community and find meaning as when he loves the community or whatever. It sounds like he, just listened to the list of everything here from all the speakers you've had. So do you think there's any one or two speakers that, or you know, a few that really got good tips from, good points from that were not necessarily good, but like good listeners thought, oh, that's me. That I need to take notes from this person.
What was the question?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Do you think there's any one person or two people that were like, they listened to in your support groups that he thought would be good to get notes from, get information from?
I think that I'm not really good at remembering speakers, to be honest with you. I think that it's a lot about, you know,
spot there.
What?
I didn't mean put you guys on the spot there.
No, it's okay. I mean, what I'm going to say is I think that when you sit down and you listen to a speaker, it's, do you want to get something out of it? And if you want to get something out of it, I do believe that we're always going to hear what we need to hear. And it might be that you listen to the same talk, you know, today, and you listen to it in 3 months and you hear something totally different. So, I mean, I don't really know who would be the quote unquote best person to sit down and, you know, take notes from. I think sometimes the biggest thing is just knowing that you're not in this alone.
Might be,
you know, bigger than the advice. It's more just seeing people that have come back from it or are dealing with it but are content and okay with it. But Tay, I'm going to pass it to you.
Just to add on to what you said, like, maybe not like content and okay with it, but like I think more like acceptance that, you know, like this is what it's like, you know, like, I don't know that there's any one speaker about like everyone should like, you know, go listen to, because like they had the best share ever. They like, you know, so great, like whatever. Like Emily said, like it's kind of like it's what you get out of it is like it depends on you. And just like how like she said, like you could listen to the same share like at different time intervals and you'll get something different from it. Just like, I mean, I'm rereading The Ghost in My Brain for the book club and I'm getting something different from it than I got from it like a year and a half ago when I read it, you know. But I think it definitely does come down to the just like knowing that you aren't alone, and that like other people understand to an extent, like, and like hear you, you know. And I think that's the like most important thing about like our speaker share. He's just like shows everyone, you know, like you're not alone. It does get better. You know, it's not terrible forever. Though I must say he is very resourceful. Anytime I talk to him, he's always offering to send me something about something. He's definitely a helper. He, like, anytime, like, I remember talking to him about, like, man, like, my sleep's terrible, and he'd be, like, trying to find anything to help me with my sleep. He just always has a resource for something. You could ask that guy about anything, he'd be like, oh yeah, I've got this thing here, let me send it to you. And if he doesn't, he'll try and find out something for you. It's great. Nice. And I'm glad that he got to talk to the support group.
Me too. It was awesome.
It really was. All right. So thanks, Nick, for helping us do the podcast. And thanks again to Yi for joining us and sharing with the support group. We'll have a new podcast posted Monday morning. Our upcoming podcasts can be found on concussiontalk.com, Spotify, YouTube, and Apple Podcasts. You can find more information about our group on concussionmtl.com. Our free peer-to-peer support group is open to everyone, and we hold 4 weekly meetings on Zoom, and we're always looking for Thursday morning speakers. Thank you.
HeadCheck Health bridges gaps in concussion care through simple, powerful technology. Join organizations like the Canadian Football League, Trek Factory Racing, the Canadian Junior Hockey League, Eastern Washington University, and Volleyball Canada, who rely on HeadCheck to improve communication and optimize care. Visit headcheckhealth.com for more. The music at the beginning of this podcast is by Ben Sound. www.bensound.com.